Coming up on Only a Game, discourse on some dramatic disc doings. It is said to have begun with a pie plate. After somebody ate the pie out of it, that somebody discovered that with a flick of the wrist, the plate could be made to sail through the air toward somebody else. From that humble, perhaps apocryphal beginning, all manner of derivatives have sprung and dipped and skidded and sailed, as Only a Game's Karen Given now reports.
Last Sunday afternoon, in bright sunshine and light winds, 60 competitors and about twice as many spectators gathered on Boston's Esplanade, a linear park on the Charles River, for one of the world's most unusual world championships.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, dogs and cats, please put your hands together for our next team.
These competitors have come to crown the world's best at freestyle frisbee, a competition so odd that tournament directors Petri Isola and Alan Kaplan get nervous when I ask them to explain it.
Well,
you're gonna go.
You want me to explain it?
Yeah.
Okay, this is where we get into the eye of the beholder type of thing, okay? But it's characterized, I would say, by trick catches, trick throws with a disc. Also, there's the ability to spin the disc on the finger, and a number of tricks in putting that all together. It's not quite like anything else out there.
Think about Harlem Globetrotters, but with a frisbee.
Freestyle frisbee also has a lot in common with ice skating. Teams of competitors, often in costume, perform to music. Judges rate them on execution, artistic impression, and difficulty. Otherwise, there don't seem to be many rules. There are no required moves, and apparently no limit to the number of frisbees a team can use during a routine. All this freedom has spawned a long and growing list of tricks. Randy Sylvie, a competitor from Seattle, Washington, runs through a few of his favorites.
There's like the flaw, there's the flamingo, there's the gaitosis, the gaitis, the scarecrow, the flare, the indigenous. I'm trying to think, I mean, they just go on and on. The China syndrome is one. That's where you commit your whole body and you throw your legs up in the air. So what you're going to do is land on your head. So it's, kind of a commitment move. And you just got to catch it while it's up there. And it's a crash and burn move.
Just because someone knows the name of a trick doesn't mean he can perform it or even explain it. Take the move bearing everyone's favorite name. The alien birth ritual.
I never quite knew what that was, but you've got to talk to one of the legends around here.
You're asking the wrong person. That's not my style. I don't do that.
Now you got to talk to a guy named Skippy Jammer, the guy who invented it.
It's kind of hard to explain. It's a move where you put it up in an angle and you get it, you restrict it behind your leg, and you move your back around, and then you pull it back through around to your front side. And there's no way to describe it without it being a visual thing.
Well, with that explanation out of the way, let the competition continue. Cindy Krueger from Seattle, Washington, and Paul Kenny from Jacksonville Beach, Florida, take to the field for their 4-minute-long routine. Kenny's been competing for 5 or 6 years, making him a newbie by freestyle standards. But according to his fellow competitors, Kenny's signature throws with multiple frisbees have already made him a legend. Kenny takes his sport seriously. Over the past few months, he even grew out his hair and his beard to complement his hippie tie-dye costume.
It's my form of Zen exercise. It's exercise. It's that there's like a spiritual thing. You know, we'll get the boombox, you get that music, and you physically, you're physically just in the moment, and nothing else matters. You know, it's just very harmonic, if you will, so to speak. So.
4-legged athletes have their place at this event, too. Frisbee-catching dogs and their trainers are on hand to keep the crowd entertained during lags in the competition. Some of the biggest cheers of the afternoon go to the dogs, much to the aggravation of the human element, like veteran competitor Larry Imperiali.
You know, that's our worst thing. Oh, are there dogs? You know, and we practice, and and it's just so hard for us. And then you get a dog and you give him some water and a frisbee when he's a puppy, and then he's a great frisbee dog and people love him because they're so cute.
From Jacksonville, Florida, Paul Kenny and Dan Yarnell.
Paul Kenny is from Jacksonville, and Dan Yarnell is also from Jacksonville. These guys, very interesting.
As the open pairs final gets underway, Randy Sylvie agrees to talk me through a routine.
And Paul is now going, and he's like a tip sequence. He calls it the machine gun because it's just, he's just going really fast, tipping it under his leg, pop, 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 and you can hear the music going, oh my God, he's hitting it. And there he goes, and he gets his catch. Right to the tune, too. Well done, Holly.
But midway through the routine, Kenny and Yarnell run into a few problems.
Execution. So Paul just dropped another one there, and he gets a 0.3 deduction from a score of 10. So you want to keep your execution score in the 9. So that means three drops is going to be 0.3, 0.3, 0.3. So that'd be a 9-1. And that's where the winning routines, and see, they're really struggling here all of a sudden.
Kenny and Yarnell offer up one of the more difficult routines of the afternoon, with Kenny catching 6 discs in one hand for the big finale. But along the way, more than a few discs have hit the ground, and the team ends up with a third-place finish. Sylvie says upsets like this aren't uncommon in freestyle frisbee.
The execution is one of the wild cards, because you never know when a gust of wind is going to come, and that can just be a nightmare for any of the players, because it takes you out of your rhythm. You're trying to figure where you are in your routine. You don't have to worry about that in ice skating, you know, gust of wind knocking you down.
Meanwhile, on the west side of the field, sitting under the shade of a few scraggly trees, Larry Imperiali, that resenter of dogs, waits for his turn in the open pairs final. He's from Evergreen, Colorado, and he's no newcomer to stiff international competition.
We often go to Italy. I played in Slovakia. Last year I was at the World Games in Japan. Tournaments in Finland and Helsinki. And
how well do you do?
Generally pretty well.
Really well.
I've won 10 world championships. I've won tournaments in 4 decades. Don't say that on the radio. And I've even climbed a mountain in Nepal and done some frisbee tricks at over 20,000 feet.
Imperiali says freestyle frisbee is great for old guys, as he calls himself, because it takes so long to get good. But what's the real secret to Imperiali's success? He almost never practices.
Me personally, I probably play 3 times a week, but it's not practice. We call it jamming. And the worst thing is to have to go practice your routine. It's much more fun to go out there and be spontaneous.
Freestyle frisbee competitors, even successful ones like Imperiali, don't get recognized on the street. Most don't have sponsors, and the ones who do find that the money doesn't even cover travel expenses. And the cash prizes awarded at some tournaments don't go very far either. So why do they do it?
The second the last pair plays in the open pairs finals, you'll see every single competitor run out and start playing in what we call mob ops, where groups of 5 or 6 will start playing, trying to do spontaneous moves, and that's what I live for. That last throw of the last routine, I just can't wait, and I just run out there and we just all start playing together. And that's what brings me the most satisfaction in the sport. It's all about fun, because isn't that what life's all about?
From the start of Imperiali and his partner Joel Rogers' routine, it's clear the pair is having fun. And before long, it becomes clear that having fun is a pretty good way to win a world championship. While Larry Imperiali waits to hear that he's won his 11th world championship, he takes to the field for jam time. And believe it or not, he really doesn't seem to care whether or not he's won. For Only a Game, I'm Karen Given in Boston, Massachusetts.
Please welcome to the field, the NPC, Paul Stein.